thank you very much. So today I want to explain the outline, the proof of the result from last time. So I guess the format is that we go for an hour and then have a 15-minute break and then go for another hour. Is that right? Does that sound reasonable? So let me begin by recalling the theorem. So we have rho bar taking GQ to DO2K, where here, so our setup is that we have a kind of p-Adic coefficient field with ring of integers O and residue field K. And this rho bar is it's modular which is to say by virtue of the theorem of Carrier and Ventimiglia is odd and absolutely irreducible. And unramified outside some set sigma, which is contains P. And then some other prime sigma naught. And then there'll be some local assumptions. So rho bar restricted to G of QP is not isomorphic to, so it's not isomorphic to some twist of trivial by itself. So it's not an extension of a character by itself locally, or a twist of 1*0. Mod p cyclotomic. And I also want to assume that for this talk, that the endomorphisms over locally at p of rho bar are just scalar. So this is for simplicity. So then the conclusion is that we look at H1 hat, coefficients in O, our levels are in sigma, we're localizing at this modular rho bar, is isomorphic to, so let me write it this way, rho mod tensor pi mod tensor with a curly completed x. So the tensor products here are over the Hecker ring at rho bar, and rho mod takes g of q to g o 2 t of rho bar. It's the universal promodular deformation of rho bar. And pi mod is, so let me explain in just a moment. And so pi mod will be kind of what I wrote last time, pi p of rho mod restricted to G of QP. So this is the Banach T rho bar module. So representation of GO2 QP attached to this rho mod locally at P via p-Adic local Langlands. And so what I mean by the universal premodular deformation is if I don't, so last time when I said the theorem, I said that P should be 2 and rho bar should be satisfy the Taylor-Wiles condition, and then there was an R equals T theorem. But if I don't assume that, then we don't necessarily have R equals T. But there's always a map from spec T rho bar sitting inside spec R rho bar, and here you have kind of the universal deformation, and you can restrict it to the to a representation of a spec of T rho bar, and that's the universal premodular representation. So it's what you get by interpolating all the classical modular two-dimensional Galois representations that lift rho bar. So if we sort of so R rho bar will subject onto T rho bar because the traces of Frobenius here go to topological generators here, and everything is completed in the theory, and so this map is surjective. That's why. So if we don't sort of give ourselves big R equals big T, then if we just sort of forget that fact, then what we expect to see here are just things that come by interpolating classical modular forms. So it's sort of natural that then here we see kind of the interpolations of everything that comes from modular forms. And then the question of whether this T is equal to this R is sort of a separate question, which has a positive answer in most cases, should have a positive answer in all cases, but has a proved positive answer in most cases. But that's not a question that's going to be addressed by these p-Adic Langlands methods. That's a question which is addressed by traditional modularity theorem methods. Yes?
This p-Adic local Langlands, I mean, the coefficients can be as general as this TP bar.
Yeah, so I'm going to say something about this. I mean, I think I have to say something about this. But yes, they can be that general. So. And probably this assumption is redundant because of this assumption. So anyway, so this assumption says that either rho bars are irreducible or is a non-trivial extension of distinct characters. So I guess this implies this, and this assumption is needed in order to make this. So to formulate p-Adic local Langlands in a way that extends absolutely functorially to coefficient rings, at least at the moment, one needs to exclude this case. So, as we'll see. Okay, so that's the main theorem, and now I'd like to discuss the proof. Yes. No. Yeah. So I should say this X is it's an interpolation of a local Langlands at primes L in sigma naught. So it's a little bit complicated to say. So there's a precise sense of this. It's a little bit complicated to say. So I think if time permits, I'll say something about it. Well, something will fall out of the proof, and then we'll see what falls out of the argument, and we'll discover some properties of this X, and then there'll be a statement that those properties, there'll be some abstract properties of this X, which will uniquely characterize it. But they're a little unwieldy to state. It's a module over here, which is an inductive limit of finite type. Let me try again. It's so x is equal to a direct sum of a cofinite type O torsion free T rho bar modules. So cofinite type means you can take imagine you have finite type O torsion free modules over this ring, and then give them their emmatic topologies, and then take the O linear dual, and those become there's a cofinite type. So it's an direct sum of such things with some kind of smooth, so what I want to call co-admissible smooth action of the product over L in sigma naught of GL2QL. Where again, so smooth means smooth, every point is fixed by some open subgroup of this product. And co-admissible means that if you look at the stabilizer of the stable fixed space by some open subgroup, it is a cofinite type module. So it sort of basically looks like a kind of a dual of a smooth admissible representation with coefficients in this ring. So if sigma zero is empty, then x is equal to continuous O linear Homs from T rho bar to O. So a very simple cofinite type module. And in general, what will happen is that x will be So here, this x is really co-free. So in general, this x won't be co-free, because as I said last time, this rho bar can have classical lifts of, in principle, that have different types at primes L, maybe sometimes principal series or special or cuspidal, and so you can't glue those into something free or co-free. So this, but it will be co-torsion free. So it won't be co-free, but it will be co-torsion free. And the eigenspaces at a classical point, the eigenspace at that classical point will just be the tensor product of the usual local Langlands pieces. And those facts characterize this X. It's a unique object that's co-admissible, co-torsion-free, and has good eigenspaces at classical points. But it's somehow a little unwieldy. So, and one reason to kind of call it, it's called X, is just because this X, somehow in the proof, this is some unknown that appears. And then you sort of gain control of it as you make the argument. So in some sense, everything else is input and X is sort of output in the argument. So.
The
question will be like, can you think of X as some sort of a universal deformation of the local Langlands pieces attached? It's the best approximation I know to that. Again, just because. But. Yeah, I mean, somehow it's not quite clear sort of what that deformation problem is when the kind of objects at certain points that you know have different dimension, well, have sort of this different shape, and you know, how are they glued together in families? But this is the best approximation I know to a kind of, to a family, you know, to a sort of interpolating family of the classical stuff over the spec of this T rho bar, which has reasonable properties, and it's the best approximation I know to a kind of, you know, it's the only reasonable idea I know of in interpolation, but it's sort of, but I don't know how to characterize it, for example, in a kind of deformation functorial way. So so for example, somehow I wouldn't, if it had turned out that this ring had nil potents, so you really couldn't understand things just by specialization at classical points, I wouldn't really know what this should be. I mean, it's somehow important that this ring is reduced, and so somehow this X is sensible to ask that it be torsion free and that it be determined by its classical specializations. So that's in a way a sign that you don't have a good deformation theoretic point of view. So before trying to prove this, I think I have to answer Jared's question, so how to explain a little bit what this means, because we're going to have to use this object. So p-Adic local Langlands in families this is work of Comes, Kisin, and Pascunas plays a technical role. A lot of these foundational things in p-Adic local Langlands, the precise evolution of these ideas are a little complicated because everybody was meeting at the same conferences every 2 months and discussing a lot. And so in 2005 in Montreal, Pierre explained a functor. So let me begin with his functor. So here is Comes's functor, So this is similar, maybe up to a twist, agrees with a functor that he calls V. But anyway, I somehow have this notation MF, so this could stand for magical functor or mysterious functor or Montreal functor, which are all kind of good names for it. So this MF goes from admissible, smooth, GL2QP representations over Artinian, or even over just finite, over finite local O algebras to say this O algebra is called A, to Galois representation, to representations of G of QP over the coefficients A, and it's exact. And so have you explained this in your talks now? So this is up to a twist. This is Comes's functor that he calls V. So just to remind you what happens to make this functor, we take pi we choose inside it W to be, so this pi is some representation of GL2QP. Inside, we choose W, which is some finite dimensional, GO2ZP variant submodule that generates pi over GO2. And then you take W. And of course, if you act all of GL2 on it, you get pi. So that's no more than what you knew already. But you can act on it, you can look at this ring where you have the matrix P001, and then you have your coefficients A, and you have the completed group ring of ZP star 0, 0, 1. So you have A, you look at the completed group ring of ZP star over A. So this is essentially adjoins one power series variable. So A is our Artinian ring, this is some nice Noetherian ring. Then you adjoin this polynomial variable, which is P001. And so you look at this module, we can just call it kind of M. Yes, thank you. Thank you very much. So it should be exactly one polynomial variable. ZP star, I don't need to add. So in fact, ZP star is there along for the ride. Thank you. Yeah, so I do this. Rather, 1 ZP01, P001, W. This is contained in pi. And then we can look at, so then you have the key theorem due to Colmes, is that the Pontryagin dual to this M. So Pontryagin dual is finitely generated over this ring. So of course, if we didn't put in this thing, that would be clear. We would have this would be finite dimensional, and then we would act this, and it would be finitely sort of. In fact, if we didn't put this in, then you know this is invariant under DO2ZP. So this 1ZP01 wouldn't change W, and this M star will be rather small and not so interesting. But when you put in this P001, you certainly have a tendency to make this become infinitely generated over A. And what's quite non-obvious is that nevertheless, the dual is still finitely generated over this ring. So then, you can form M star tensored with, well, so now I have to abuse notation slightly. So let me write it this way. So this is a power series ring in one variable. So we can form the corresponding rational function, the corresponding Laurent series ring. So let me have this unpleasant notation to denote that. We can form this tensor product. So this is over, this is over 1 CP01. And now this is a phi gamma. This becomes a phi gamma module. So this is now a finitely generated module over these coefficients, and it has an action of p 001. Maybe to be safe, maybe it's better to kind of let me be a bit ambiguous about p versus p inverses. But maybe it's safer to say it has an action of p inverse 001, just because of taking the dual. And it has an action of ZP star 001, which just comes because W was invariant under the ZP star 001. And then that commutes with this element and normalizes this group. So this whole thing is invariant under the ZP star 001. So what do we have? We have a finitely generated module over this Laurent polynomial ring with this kind of action of this element and sort of a phi and a gamma, and that's a phi gamma module. So we have a phi gamma module, which we can then apply Fontaine's theory of phi gamma modules to get, so if we started with pi, to get some, I'm sort of calling this MF of pi. Let me call it MF of pi dual. So we get some object, which is some Galois representation, which we declare to be the dual of what we're trying to build. And then we do take the Pontryagin dual, and we get MF. So because we took a dual here, and then we took another Pontryagin dual here, in the end, what we have is a covariant functor. And the exactness is not so completely, the exactness is not completely clear, but is not, certainly this is exact. Somehow the formation of this M is not quite exact. But the key point is that when you form these M's, of course you had to make a choice of W as well, so this M's also not quite canonical. But when you do this, any choices you make, the ambiguity is always killed off when you form this tensor product. So once you form this tensor product, everything becomes canonical and exact. So that's, and so that's how we make this. That's how we make this. We just apply this whole process to the Artinian quotients of. I'm only halfway through the story. Rather, if I started with this and did that, I will get back to this rho mod. I mean, this goes from GL2 to Galois. So if I started with what I want, if I started with this pi mod and I applied this process, I will get back to rho mod. So what we need to show now is that somehow you can, that's sort of reversible. So that was a suggestion of Kisin, which was then implemented by Colmes. And the upshot is that has the following theorem, Colmes and Kisin, and the way I'm stating it, it also includes some result of Pascunis, is that so if we choose rho bar, or if we fix rho bar. So now this rho bar will be local. So this is a local rho bar going to GL2K such that rho bar is not a twist of 1 star 0 cyclotomic. And the endomorphisms of rho bar equal k. Then there exists a unique up to isomorphism admissible smooth representation pi bar of GL2QP over k such that mf of pi bar equals rho bar, and pi bar has no finite dimensional GL2QP invariant subobjects or quotients. So there's a very nice pi bar you can choose, a kind of canonically determined pi bar you can choose, which goes under MF to rho bar. And then, in fact, statement one doesn't require either of these assumptions, but the next statement requires both of them. So statement two is that when we look at this Montreal functor, so because it's exact, I will take a deformation of pi bar to a deformation of rho bar. So what do I mean by deformation of pi bar? I really mean, if I deform pi bar to A, I mean a free A module, which is an admissible smooth representation of GL2QP lifting pi bar. And then because of the exactness, what you'll get will have to be a free A module on the GL2 side lifting rho bar. So because of the exactness, this really preserves deformation functors. And then the theorem is that really this is an equivalence of deformation functors. So so kind of the role of Kisin in this, I guess, was to sort of suggest this strategy and point out that because of what one already knew about p-Adic local Langlands, it was enough to get an embedding here. which becomes a question of tangent spaces and a question of x. And then Pierre, in about 5 seconds flat, computed those x and got sort of showed the requisite result. But then there's a slightly tricky issue with central characters, which Pascunas noticed, and sort of, so this statement doesn't mention central characters, and it doesn't have to, so for those who know about this tricky issue, that's where I'm using the simplification. So this result, in fact, it guarantees this pi bar automatically has the same property, it turns out, so that this, so both deformation functors are really well defined. And then there's some tricky issue with central characters, which goes away again because of this assumption. So, admissible, smooth representation.
Oh, okay. So a priori does not have to be irreducible.
And in fact, it's not necessarily. So I think just for kind of cultural reasons, it's maybe good to explain what this pi bar is. So, and this will also serve to kind of normalize my MF. So if rho bar is irreducible, pi bar is irreducible and supersingular, meaning not a subquotient of a parabolic induction. So, and we could be precise, but I mean, let me not be more precise here. I think it's sort of, it's certainly easier and reasonably illuminating just to write down what happens in the reducible cases. So if rho bar is an extension of characters, and chi 2 chi 1 inverse does not equal the inverse cyclotomic, then pi bar is an extension. So we do an induction from the Borel to GL2 of chi 1 on the first entry, and then chi 2 times the cyclotomic on the second entry. And then we have pi bar. And then we have the induction of chi 2 on the first entry, chi 1 cyclotomic goes to 0. So again, just for simplicity, I'm assuming that when my rho bar is an extension, I'm assuming it's non-split. But in fact, a suitably modified version of this statement would hold even under just this assumption. And then, in particular, if this rho bar was split, this pi bar would be split. And if this rho bar is non-split, this pi bar is non-split. Because of my assumption on these ratios, if that star is non-split, the extension class is unique. And one can show that this extension class, if it's non-split, is unique. And so there is a kind of matching. So you could wonder sort of what's the principle? Is there any principle at all kind of governing the situation? Well, of course, there's this functor, which is a reasonable principle that governs the situation. But at a slightly more ad hoc level, one could say that, so first of all, this correspondence is compatible with semi-simplification. So that this star being zero or not just affects whether this is split or not. And then imagine that we're in the semi-simple case. Then, of course, chi 1 and chi 2 have, there's no preferred ordering. So you can't have a preferred ordering in the pi bar. So what would happen in classical local Langlands is that you would form this induction. I mean, you don't use the cyclotomic character, but you use the norm, which is the the corresponds to the cyclotomic character under local Langlands. And then what you would know is that, again, because of this assumption, that in fact these two were isomorphic by an intertwiner. So it wouldn't matter which one you wrote down, and the order wouldn't matter. But these are not isomorphic mod p. So it matters which way you choose the order, and you somehow don't have a choice, so you have to have both. So you have no choice but to take the direct sum. And then, in general, why do you have this X? Well, it seems that what happens is that rather than having intertwiners in characteristic P, you have some kind of derived intertwiners. So, for example, so if you're on a group G, if you're looking at, say, inductions from the Borel and you're on some group G, then you know, you have, if you sort of fix your Borel, then you can think about all the open orbit, all the sort of Schubert cells labeled by the elements of the Weyl group. And if you apply some permutation to the character, you don't get an intertwiner, but at least generically what will happen is there'll be a unique X, and it will be in some degree, which is like the length of W, the length of the Weyl group element labeling the cell. So somehow all the intertwiners get somehow shift, there's a shift of cohomological degree in all the intertwiners for some reason. So that's what's happening here. So there's an interesting case if rho bar is equal to chi star 0 chi times inverse cyclotomic, then pi bar is an extension of chi composed of determinant by chi tensored with Steinberg going to pi bar going to the induction to GL2. So then we should use this rule, so I should flip things the other way, so I should have chi times cyclotomic inverse tensor chi times cyclotomic. So, and now, just because, I mean, I'm assuming I'm not in this situation. So in particular, I'm assuming now implicitly that P is at least 5, so that cyclotomic and cyclotomic inverse are different. This is really irreducible. So this is kind of, so this pi bar has three Jordan Holder factors, a one-dimensional one, a twist of Steinberg, and then this induction. And now this star, there's a choice of star. Now, the X here have dimension 2. And there's this kind of Perrier-Maffei versus Trier-Maffei extensions. And so it turns out that the extensions here have dimension 2. And then whatever extension you choose here, there's no choice about what extension to make here. So somehow the kind of subtlety between Perrier and Trier-Maffei occurs here. And so, for example, what will happen is in the Perrier-Maffei case, so this extension is always going to be non-split, but in the Perrier-Maffei case, when you restrict to GL2 ZP, it becomes split. So that's the kind of case where you can find a GL2 ZP invariant vector in this pi bar, and that corresponds to the fact that Perrier-Maffei should be prime to P in the level. It should be unramified. There should be GL2 ZP invariant vectors. And in the Trier-Maffei case, this extension only splits on a smaller congruent subgroup. So, and one can also notice that this guy is, so the chi is an extension of this by this. So this is the sub, this is the quotient. So this one-dimensional piece is safely sitting in the middle of the Jordan Holder series, in between something infinite dimensional at the bottom and something infinite dimensional at the top. And so it's not violating condition one. I mean, this one-dimensional piece is somehow neither a quotient nor a sub. It's truly a genuine subquotient. And so one thing that happens is that this functor is not quite faithful, this Montreal functor, because if pi is really finite dimensional, then you may as well imagine pi is equal to w, and then m will be equal to w, and m dual will be w dual. It'll be finite dimensional. So it will have to be torsion over this power series ring, and so you'll get zero. So this functor is sort of factors through the quotient category where you kill off all the finite dimensional objects. And so here you have this sort of interesting feature that in the quotient category, this one-dimensional piece is killed, but the extension class survives in the quotient category. It kind of becomes an extension of this by this in the quotient category. So, so that's something about pi bar. So I also need to say a little bit about how this is proved, because I'll need some of the ingredients later. So there are three ingredients. There's this functor. There's the computation on tangent spaces to show that this is a priori a closed embedding. And then you need one more ingredient. Once you have a closed embedding to kind of get an equality, you somehow need to show the image is dense. So you need to exhibit points that I should say that these spaces are smooth because of this assumption. These spaces are smooth, at least the characteristic P fibers are smooth, and they're always reduced. So to show that we have an equivalence, we only need to show the image is dense. There's no scheme structure. And so luckily, Berger and Breuil exhibited some points in the image sort of before the story of this functor. So I need to say something about that. So what do you need to do? So here's result of Berger and Christophe Breuil is that suppose rho mapping G of QP to GL2E is a lift of rho bar. That is crystalline with distinct conjugate weights and has semi-simple crystalline Frobenius. So a useful thing to remember is that crystalline with distinct Hodge-Tate weights, in the global context, that's going to mean a modular form of weight at least 2 of level prime to p. And semi-simple crystalline Frobenius is a very technical condition. So it says that if the Frobenius eigenvalues it rules out the case where the Frobenius eigenvalues coincide. I'm sorry, I should have also said that this rho should be irreducible. It's important here that rho is irreducible. So when this rho is irreducible, so if the crystalline Frobenius has a repeated eigenvalue, then an argument with weak immiscibility shows that it can't be scalar. It has to really be a generalized eigenvalue. Now again, this is expected to be automatically true in the global context because of the Tate conjecture, but we don't know the Tate conjecture for higher weight modular forms, so we have to pay a little bit of attention to this condition. So anyway, if you have such a row, what they showed is that, so here's their theorem, is that they showed that then there exists. No, but I'm a little worried about the. Yeah, so I just want to exclude that altogether. And also, I'm a bit worried about, I'm not sure exactly what Vitas proved about universal completions, which is a statement I need. So I think I'm going to put something here which I'm not sure Vitas proved. And also, he had p-odd, I think. I'm thinking he might have had p-odd, I can't quite remember. But so anyway, I think for exactly everything I'm going to write here, I have to worry about this case. So there exists um, So they exist. Okay. So they exist pi rho. Banach space representation, in fact, an admissible Banach space representation of GL2QP over E. In fact, sorry, this, there are too many adjectives. An admissible unitary Banach space representation of GL2QP over E. So what does that mean? That means that there exists a GL2 invariant O lattice L contained in pi rho such that when I reduce modulo the uniformizer of O, I get something admissible smooth. Sorry, this sentence has to continue, but what this means is that you have a Banach space representation. Unitary is the same abusive language that p-Adic Banach space people use when they talk about orthonormal bases. So unitary just really means that there's an invariant lattice. And once you have an invariant lattice, you can reduce it modulo the uniformizer. When you have this action should be a continuous representation, so we can, to be careful, we should put that in. So it's a continuous representation. So when you reduce modulo the uniformizer, this really becomes a smooth representation. It becomes continuous in the discrete topology. So then it makes sense to ask if it's admissible. And if it is, we say that what we had was admissible, and it turns out to be independent of the choice of lattice. So there exists this pi rho. And this pi rho is lifting pi bar. Well, such that, well, again, what I mean by lifting pi bar is that if we choose the lattice carefully, this is equal to pi bar. So lifting pi bar means that, i.e. L mod pi L equals pi bar for some choice of L. And such that the MF of pi rho is equal to rho. So that's part of the theorem. There's going to be another part I have to explain in a minute. So again, what do I mean by MF of pi rho? Well, I should choose the lattice, form MF of the lattice, and then invert, then tensor up with E again. And then again, what you construct will be independent of the choice of lattice. And so this is giving us some points in the image of this map. We're giving some E-valued points of the space coming from here. And then there's a second statement. So which tells you, so the second statement tells you how to actually construct this pi rho. So furthermore, if the Hodge-Tate weights of rho are, yeah, so, well, 0 and 1 minus k, which is, so let me just, I mean, that's up to a twist. Let me assume minus zero, then my statements just become slightly simpler. And here, I'm assuming the Hodge-Tate weights are distinct, so I can assume that k is at least 2. So this is what would happen for a weight k modular form. And if Vedelin of rho equals the Vedelin rep attached to D decrease of rho. In other words, I just remember the, it's unramified, I just remember the phi, I throw away the filtration. Then pi rho, we can describe pi rho. So how do we describe it? Well, we can do it this way. We apply usual local Langlands. We apply local Langlands to this Vedeline representation, and now we have a smooth admissible representation of GL2QP. Then we tensor with sim k minus 2 of e squared. And now we have a locally algebraic representation of GL2QP. So locally algebraic in the sense that what is a smooth representation? Every vector locally on the group behaves as if it's fixed. So it's somehow the action is locally constant. So here, every vector locally in the group behaves as if it's in an algebraic representation. So it's locally algebraic. And now this is not at all a Banach-space thing. This, again, looks like a kind of a countable sum of copies of E with no kind of completion. But then we take the universal unitary completion of this. So in other words, you can just somehow look at the category of all unitary admissible, or just all unitary Banach space representations that this maps to, and there turns out to be an initial object that's universal unitary completion. And that's how you make this pi rho. And so what this statement reflects, what it reflects is that this decrease rho has a priori a piece of information. So rho has a piece of information which a priori is not encoded here, which is the Hodge filtration. But in fact, because I'm assuming that I'm crystalline and irreducible and two-dimensional, the Hodge filtration is a torus orbit in P1 minus 2 points, and that's just a single orbit. So the Hodge filtration is somehow not actually there. There's no data in the Hodge filtration. So it's reasonable to at least imagine that thus this information could capture all of rho. And then the theorem of Béjart and Broglie says that, in fact, it does capture all of rho.
So WD of rho is unramified, right?
Yeah. So this is an...
Go on. What I want to know is what goes wrong with this process when rho, WD of rho is not unramified? Does the universal unitary completion just not exist?
No, it exists. So if... So I'm... I mean, I could have said more. So if, in fact, if we become... crystalline even over an abelian extension. So Christabelin, so that if this is a ramified principal series, it's still the case that the Hodge filtration here is forced, and then this will turn out to still be true. But if this is genuinely semi-stable or even irreducible, so in the supercapsular case, then this universal completion will exist, but it won't be irreducible, and in fact, it won't be admissible. It'll have massive infinite length and highly non-admissible. And in some sense, Christoph's Broglie's original formulation of p-Adic local Langlands was somehow the quest to understand what all the quotients will be of this completion, all the different quotients that would have meaning and that would kind of capture the Hodge filtration. So what you can imagine is that if you have a huge representation of GL2QP, some Banach space representation, and you're looking for quotients, you can think about kind of all the maximal GL2QP, all the proper maximal sub-representations. And then the quotients by them give you irreducible quotients. So that's some kind of a priori huge Grassmannian. And roughly Christoph's philosophy, I think, was that, well, at least this Grassmannian or some part of it turns out to be just the Grassmannian of Hodge filtrations on D rho. Unfortunately, no one's really understood how being able to prove things from that point of view. But that's kind of the idea, is that there's kind of a natural Grassmannian here and a natural Grassmannian sort of here. And amazingly, I mean, Christoph had this amazing idea, they could really be connected somehow. So that's, yeah.
Jean-François? This universal unitary completion, is that the completion for finite generated?
Yes, yeah. Yeah, so it's, yeah. So what Jean-François said, it's easy to describe this explicitly. You just, this thing is irreducible. So you take any non-zero vector and it generates it over GL2QP, over the group ring of GL2QP with E coefficients. So now you can look at what, you can take that vector and you can look at what happens when you apply GL2QP with O coefficients. And you get some O submodule, which will certainly span this as an E vector space. And then that's the completion you take. And the first issue, I mean, the thing you're kind of that's not at all obvious at the beginning. So you, again, just because E is countably rank over O, I mean, countably generated over O as an O module, it could be that this completion could be zero a priori. And that's in some sense the kind of first thing you have to fight against. That would be the kind of worst case scenario, but that's sort of a big part of the battle somehow is just to try and show that this thing is non-zero. And so, so in fact, in the supercuspidal case, it's much easier to see it's non-zero because matrix coefficients have compact support. And so then it's somehow easy to, so then this universal completion is sort of easy to compute, and it's also easy to see that it's huge. And then in the semi-stable case, this universal completion is harder to compute, but it was sort of shown to be non-zero when k is even by Jeremy Teitelbaum, and then when for general k by Grosser-Klonner. But then in the principal series case, that turns out to be the hardest case to show that it's even non-zero. So, So one thing you can check is that's the back of the envelope computation is at least here the central characters work out so that this has unitary central character. If we'd taken the Vedelin representation that didn't have a unitary central character, then we could still try and play a game like this, but then you would have a non-unitary central character, and then, for example, you would automatically, this O lattice would automatically be the whole E vector space, and you would have no completion. So, okay. So that's the kind of deformation theoretic formulation of p-Adic local Langlands, and I mean the sort of argument now says, well, we have a whole bunch of things in the image, and in fact a kind of local version of the infinite fern of Gewehre-Mayser shows that these row are in fact Zariski dense here, and they're in the image of MF. And so that's the third ingredient you need to kind of construct this isomorphism. And so I guess time to take a break. And so when we come back, I'll use this ingredient to prove the theorem. And it will have a very similar flavor that we will use a global level. I mean, we'll somehow use globally the fact that such points are dense will be an important ingredient. And the other kind of key feature will be to recognize, which is, so you can see the proof is really going to be cheating. Because we somehow, the fact we use is that to recognize that we have a Banach space attached to such a row, all we have to do is exhibit this locally algebraic representation in our kind of space we're trying to understand. And if you have a unitary Banach space containing this, it contains a completion of this, which is then an image of the universal completion. But then if the universal completion is this pi rho, so it's irreducible, and so that map has to be an isomorphism. And so we can produce this pi of rho inside any candidate space just by producing this. And Langlands, Salin, and Carriol have told us how to produce this. So that's sort of going to be a key step in the argument. But the details can come after the break.
About this other
Yes. No, so those X2s are, at least naively somehow, one doesn't have an analog of an Euler characteristic formula, for example, in this dual 2 category, and so these X2s look sort of, these X1s are already a bit of a battle to compute, and the X2s, I don't know that anyone's really computed much about these X2s. It's, in fact, the kind of precise homological algebra of these categories, this admissible Smith category and characteristic P, seems to be really something of a battle. And it's not one. I mean, it's a battle that's ongoing and somehow not one. So, yeah. We computed a lot of X1s. Did he compute some X2s? Yeah, that's right. Yes, he computed some X2s. That's true. So yeah, I mean, Pascunus is somehow, he has more tools, he has more weapons in this battle than anyone else somehow. Secret weapons in a way. But I think the underlying, you can see the sort of a homological story here. I think the underlying homological story is probably not, really understood. There are hints in the work of Pascunas and in other things, but especially for a group other than GL2QP, there's all the signs of a... Okay. Okay. So now we have some local ingredients. We can try and use them to prove our global statement. So I'm going to need H1 hat O sigma rho bar. I'll recall its definition and use that as a chance to introduce a little more notation. So last time, I mean, when I defined H1 hat, it was an inductive limit over levels prime to p coming from sigma naught. And so those are sometimes that's technically easier to work with, so I just want to give them a name. So here, k sigma naught will just be some compact open inside the product of the GL2QLs, where L is in sigma naught. And so this is the, so this thing now is what we, as last time, it's we take H1, we take it in X, well, so some level at P to the R, sort of times the level coming from this open subgroup. Coefficients in O, I localize at my rho bar, so meaning I localize at the maximal ideal in the Hecker algebra attached to rho bar, but let me just use a subscript rho bar. I p-adically complete, I take the limit over R, and then I p-adically complete that whole thing. So that's our completed cohomology. And how are we going to study it? So we make a definition. So we define X k sigma naught to be the Homs over, so we have our coefficient ring, we have GQ, we have GL2QP, we have our universal permodular rho, we have our universal, we have our corresponding pi. So again, remember now that pi and rho are linked via this equivalence of our deformation functors. So rho mod is some deformation of the global rho bar. So restricted to GQP, it's some deformation of the local rho bar. And then pi mod is the associated Banach module. So we look at the Homs of that into H1 hat k sigma naught O rho bar. So we want to try and show that this guy is made up out of these guys. So we just hum in and, you know, see what we have and hope that, you know, hope that things work. So we can try and figure out some properties of this. So X of K sigma naught. So what properties does it have? Well, it inherits some properties just from properties of the target. For example, the target is O torsion free. So this is a torsion free. The target is was constructed to be complete, so it's, well, p-Adically, or I'm going to say p-Adically complete. And another property that's slightly less obvious is that it's co-finitely generated over T rho bar. So why is that? Well, if you have a kind of compact module, say, over a complete Noetherian local ring, and you want to see if it's finitely generated, you use Nakayama's lemma. So here we have to use a kind of a, either well, Co-Nakayama's lemma or Nakayama's co-lemma. So for the third point, we have to look at, well, so roughly reducing mod M should be dual to taking M torsion. But we have to be a little bit careful, because when I say co-finitely generated, what I mean is it is an O dual to something. And when you're doing O duals, I mean, O is itself dual over itself, and it doesn't have any torsion. So if you want to kind of compare things, if you're taking O duals and then you want to kind of make arguments using the maximal ideal, you should first reduce everything modulo the uniformizer. So what we have to look at is we have to take our x. We should reduce it modulo the uniformizer of O. So we reduce modulo the uniformizer of O. And then we look at the torsion under the maximal ideal of our coefficient ring. And we have to show that this is finite dimensional over k. So, well, how do we do that? Well, we just look at the definition, and we see immediately that this embeds into the Homs over k. Well, I mean, what happens? You reduce modulo pi, so you get maps from here into this thing modulo the uniformizer. But then you want them to be killed by M. If you want them to be killed by M, that means that they should factor here through the quotient by M, which gives us pi bar, rho bar, and pi bar. So we end up getting Homs with coefficients in K from GQ to GL2QP from pi bar tensor rho bar into H1. So let me just write H1 with coefficients in k, that level p to the infinity, sort of times k sigma naught. I mean, sort of that's, I mean, again, when you reduce modulo pi, the completion goes away. And so we end up in sort of H1 with coefficients in k at sort of this, at some p power, arbitrary p power level and fixed level away from p. And then we want to show it's finite dimensional. So rho bar is just two-dimensional. So this just embeds into rho bar tensor over k with the Homs over k GL2QP of pi bar into the same thing. So from the point of view of just counting a dimension, rho bar is irrelevant because it's just two-dimensional. And so now we have to think about this map. These, and so we have to show that this is finite dimensional. Well, why is that? Well, pi bar, we know, is either irreducible or length 2 or length 3. In particular, it's finitely generated. So pi bar is generated over the group ring of GL2QP by its invariance under some congruent subgroup for R large enough, just because it's a finitely generated smooth representation. And so the generators are fixed by some congruent subgroup. And so therefore, the Homs, the GL2QP Homs from pi bar into H1, sort of H1 at level p to the infinity k sigma naught, they embed into just the k Homs. Well, we take the invariance under this. Sorry, this should say Zp. We take the invariance under this congruent subgroup, and they have to, this is equivariant, so they have to land in the invariance. So this means we get H1 that level p to the r times this other level away from p. And now that's finite dimensional because pi bar is immiscible. And this is finite dimensional because this is the H1 of some modular curve of just some fixed level. And so this is finite dimensional. So so that shows that our, so that gives the third point. And so, okay, so now so we have the natural evaluation map. The natural evaluation map, which is from rho mod tensor over t rho bar of pi mod tensored over t rho bar of this x to h1, again this is complete, so we can p-adically complete this tensor product and that will also map. So we have this natural map, and so the key proposition is this is an isomorphism. And then once you know that's an isomorphism, we can take the direct limit over all the k sigma naughts, and we'll get rho mod tensor pi mod curly completed with x, isomorphic to h1 hat, and that will be the theorem we want. And all that's left, if we care to do it, is to figure out exactly what x looks like in the limit. So this is essentially what we need to prove. And so how do you prove that this is an isomorphism? Well, so the proof has two steps. So the first is we show that this is surjective after inverting p. And then the second is this is injective after reducing modulo the uniformizer and then passing to the M torsion. So this is just a slightly topologicalized version of the idea that if you have you have a map of O modules and you want to show it's an isomorphism, well, If you show it's an isomorphic surjective after 10 string E, then what you know is that the co-kernel is torsion, at least. And there might be a kernel. But then you can detect, but then if you reduce modulo P and it's an injection, that somehow is both ruling out the torsion in the co-kernel and the existence of the kernel, as long as the kernel has some reasonable finiteness property so that it couldn't just vanish when you reduce modulo P. And in our situation, we have enough reasonable finiteness properties now that, you know, that this will work. And again, that's a typical local ring argument to somehow detect that the kernel is non-zero or the co-kernel is non-zero. It's enough to look at the M torsion part and see if that's non-zero. So in other words, we don't even have to look at all of this. We just have to take the M torsion part. So okay, so here we have to use Berger-Breuil. So here we use Berger-Breuil plus cofinite generation of X. So that I'll explain more, of course, but that was the basic idea. And here we use the use the structure of pi bar. So again, a key point, maybe we have to use a little more. But a key point is that once we're looking at M torsion, as we already saw, we don't have to think about rho bar and pi bar. So investigating this question is investigating, at least it reduces to a question about this rho bar and this pi bar and how they can map into the H1. There's somehow no deformations, there's no Hecker algebras anymore. So it's a relatively concrete question. So we'll do each of these steps. And let's just begin with step one. So step one. So the first thing we need to do is show at least that this X is non-zero. And in fact, we're going to try and do more. So we're going to try and show that this X is co-supported, or we are in fact going to show that this X is co-supported over all of T. In other words, it has, but it's dual to some finite type T module. And so that finite type T module has a support. We're going to show that finite type T module has full support. And then, so it sort of helps to just make some preliminary remarks. So if P is a closed point of the spec of T rho bar invert P, so we're kind of, in other words, this is a characteristic zero lift of rho bar to some p-Adic field, essentially, then X K sigma naught P torsion tensored with E is finite-dimensional and dual to the residue field of P tensored over T rho bar of the Homs to O, the O Homs. Right. And this, but this is a finitely generated module. That's what the cofinite generation statement means. And so it has fibers. And at least for close points in the characteristic zero fiber here, you can detect those fibers by looking at eigenspaces in this module. So now So now we have to do the following thing. So we want to show that if rho taking GQ to GL2E is a lift of rho bar, that is attached modular form of weight k at least 2, and level prime to p such that rho restricted to g of qp has a semi-simple crystalline Frobenius, so we're outside this sort of funny exceptional situation. Then has level, I just mean it has level k sigma naught, so it's prime to p, and then it, at the primes away from p, it's this exact level. Then the p torsion is non-zero. So to do that, we have to put, we have to relate this modular form to our h1 hat. Oh, yes?
So this is a p now and p
corresponds to? So here this p corresponds to the lift rho. So this is the close point in the characteristic zero fiber of the deformation space corresponding to our lift. So what we have to do is we have to put this modular form that's implicitly here into H1 hat somehow, and then apply Langlands Cylind Carriol, the kind of classical local global compatibility, and then apply the Berger-Breuil universal completion statement, and then we'll get what we want. So how do we do that? So we begin by looking at H1 tilde with coefficients in sim k minus 2 of e squared, which is, and well, the level will be k sigma naught, but let me suppress that. So this will be the limit over all r of h1 of the modular curve of level p to the r k sigma naught with coefficients in coefficients in the local system attached to this representation of GL2 completed. And everything here will be localized at rho bar. Yes, the limit's inside. And now, sorry, this should be some hat. But now we use the fact that we can kind of rewrite this. So this is the same as an inverse limit over S as a limit over R of H1 with coefficients in OE mod the uniformizer to the S. Again, localize it group I. Yes, I do. Thank you again. Well, let me invert P. So there's sort of two ways to take this completion. There's somehow using there's sort of integral but characteristic zero coefficients and taking a limit and then completing, or there's torsion coefficients taking an inductive limit, then taking a projective limit over the torsion coefficients. And a priori, this one maps to this one. And a priori, there could be a co-kernel. The way in modular curves, the co-kernel will be some H2, which already is not much. If I work with open modular curves, that already goes away. I'm localizing at rho bar, that goes away. We could find even other arguments to show it goes away. So for lots of reasons, this is really an isomorphism. If we were in a more general space, if we had a higher rank group and we were in some middle cohomology, then there will be an embedding here and the co-kernel will be controlled by some p-divisible torsion in some higher cohomology, and it could really be a mess to compare the two. But in the modular curve cases, that's not enough space in cohomology for a mess to happen. So these are the same. And what's the advantage of thinking this way? Well, now we see that when we take this limit, once we get to a congruent subgroup of level p to the r, the action here is trivial. So this factors out. And so we see that we can pull out the coefficients. And then we end up with just h1 hat at level k sigma naught, tensored with sim k minus 2 e squared. And sorry, this is O rho bar, and the tensor is over O. I mean, the coefficients pull out, and then I run this equality backwards, but now with trivial coefficients, and I end up having H1 hat, but tensored with the sim k minus 2. So here are things which can know about higher weight modular forms, and they're related to our H1 hat. And so So in fact, what we see is that H1 k sigma naught sim k minus 2 e squared. So now without a completion. So I take a limit but don't complete. This thing tensored with sim k minus 2 e squared dual. So the H1 without the completion maps to the H1 with the completion. I've tensored with the dual. Well, so then I map to here. Then I've tensored with the dual. So I compare this factor with the dual, and I land in H1 hat. So this naturally maps to H1 hat. And again, if I localize it rho bar, then here I land in this thing tensored with E, localized at rho bar. So I have a natural map where I have the kind of cohomology, the classical cohomology with the twisted coefficients, tensored with the dual vector space that gave rise to the twisted coefficients, mapping to my completed cohomology. So this is somehow why we don't ever need to consider completed cohomology with twisted coefficients. And now this map has to be an injection, because there can be no kernel, because this is algebraic and this is smooth. There's just somehow no way those two can interfere to produce a kernel. So there's no kernel in this map. So we get this injection. So now, well, so now we, well, so now, so classical local global compatibility plus Berger-Breuil show that the HOMs from So we have our, oops. So what hums? I'm doing hums. I have E vector spaces. I have a representation of the Gawa group and GL2. So what do I have? I have my rho, which is my lift I was talking about. I have the pi rho restricted to G of QP. This is the representation that Berger-Breuil make. That maps to H1 hat K sigma naught tensored with E. We see that's non-zero. I mean, why? Well, because inside here, right, rho was corresponding to a weight K modular form of level K sigma naught. So it contributes its Gawa representation tensored with its multiplicity space in here. And now by classical local global compatibility of Langlands and Deligne and Carriol, we know that that multiplicity space at the prime P is what local Langlands attaches to rho. And so we have in here the Gawa representation, tensored the classical local Langlands, tensored the sim K minus 2. And, well, there's a dual. This is just a question of central characters and so on. We can ignore that. Everything will work itself out. And so we have now a map to this Banach space. So it tautologically factors through the universal completion, which Berger and Breuil told us was rho tensor pi of rho. So we have a hom here. So something is non-zero, and that is exactly this space. Because if we take, so somewhere here is the first step. So we first show this is non-zero. So what is this? Right, this is exactly to give a map. So you have to give a map from the rho universal to the pi universal that maps into H1 hat but lands in the p eigenspace. So such a map will have to factor through the quotient by p on the source. So it will have to factor through here, and it will have to land in the p eigenspace, and that's where we're landing. So we've exhibited our point. So we have some non-zero cofibers. So next, so such P are up to twisting, in fact, even without up to twisting, I guess. So such P are, so these P that we just worked with are Zariski dense. Inspect T rho bar. So why is that? Well, that's, I guess, really due to cats. Maybe cats plus Coleman-Mazur, as I'll explain. So this T rho bar, what is it? It's the projective limit of Hecker algebras acting on weight 2 modular forms of fixed level K sigma naught and arbitrary P power level. But Katz showed in his theory of p-Adic modular forms that that's the same as if you fix a level to be prime to P. So just take level K sigma naught, but let the weight become arbitrary. So except for this condition, these P are dense, Zariski dense inspect T by Katz. And then if we're at, to have a non-semisimple crystalline Frobenius is, we're in this sort of funny situation where the eigenvalues coincide, which shouldn't happen anyway, but if it does, Coleman and Mazur have given us a beautiful eigencurve where we can perturb slightly along the eigencurve and just move to some nearby point where nearby means the weight is p-adically nearby, which is somehow means it goes from being 5 to being 5 plus 11 to the 29,000. And so suddenly one eigenvalue doesn't change very much in the eigencurve, and the other one changes massively, and they can't have a chance to be equal anymore. So you can always perturb away from the kind of funny, exceptional case. And so we have this. So now if you look over, hopefully I had the sense to leave it on the board, over here, we have this finitely generated module, and it has non-zero fibers, a Dedrusky dense set of points, so it has full support. So therefore, these continuous O-homs from X K sigma naught to O has full support on spec of T rho bar. For all fibers in non-zero. Let me keep that up because I need this. So therefore, x k sigma naught p is non-zero for all p closed points of spec T rho bar 1 on P, because I just have this statement backwards. So, and now that means I have lots of homs from, if I choose now any point here, any closed point, I have a hom from the right row in the right Banach space into the eigenspace in H1 hat. So, so what can I do with that? So now, if we now let P range over points corresponding to weight two modular forms, we get non-zero maps from, well, we get the row attached to P. So this is sort of the row attached to P, tensor the Banach space attached to P, into H1 hat K sigma naught, the P eigenspace. And so somehow most of these row, will be irreducible locally at P, just because if you somehow choose a random weight two modular form, it probably wasn't ordinary at P. Some a priori could be ordinary at P. If they're ordinary at P, then just as in the mod P situation, when the row bar was reducible, the pi bar was reducible. So if this row is reducible locally at P, this will be reducible. But a little argument will show always that this is an injection. So normally it's an injection for easy reasons because the source is irreducible, and occasionally it's an injection after a little argument. So you have these injections. And this has non-zero smooth vectors by Comez. And on the other hand, one can compute, so if you do Hochschild-Serre, implies that H hat 1 k sigma naught smooth is exactly just H1 k sigma naught. Here, I should say again, here everything is tensored with E. Everything's tensored with E. So suddenly the H1 before you complete maps to the H1 after you complete. And then I claim that the image is exactly the smooth vectors. So that somehow you have to show that taking invariance under open subgroups of GL2QP kind of passes through the completion. And And so for such a question, you have to investigate a Hochschild's air spectral sequence. But in that sequence, the flanking terms will be an H0 and an H2, and they'll vanish after we localize at our rho bar. So again, to be safe, we could everywhere here localize at rho bar. So what's happening is that here we have non-zero smooth vectors. We have this irreducible Gaussian representation. This irreducible Gaussian representation tends to the non-zero smooth vectors here, a mapping to this eigenspace. And what is this? Again, by local global compatibility, this is the same Gaussian representation tends to an irreducible smooth representation. So this must be an isomorphism of eigenspaces after we pass the smooth vectors. So using classical local global compatibility, we see that the rho attached to our point tends to the pi attached to our point after we pass the smooth vectors maps isomorphically to this eigenspace after we pass the smooth vectors. Well, k is 2. I mean, this is the argument in the paper is slightly different, but somehow this does seem slightly easier to say now. Somehow, if you wanted to avoid appealing to this rather hard theorem of Colmes, we could make another argument with higher weight forms instead, which is a little, using Berger-Breuil again, is a little easier. But since anyway, this is true, so we can use it. And so what do we see? So that's happening at each prime p. So if you kind of take the direct sum over all p of these, what do we have? We have all the smooth vectors. I mean, the smooth vectors is H1. It's a direct sum of the different eigenspaces. So if we take the direct sum, we get all the smooth vectors. So we see that the image of the evaluation map from our universal rho tensored our universal pi, tensored with x, k sigma naught, going to H1 hat, k sigma naught. And now I'm tensing everything with E. That contains the dense subspace that contains the dense subspace of smooth things, the things we got before completing. And now we use a nice piece of functional analysis sort of discovered by Schneider and Teitelbaum. Everything inside is admissible, so the image has to be closed. So therefore, our evaluation map is onto after tensoring with E. So this is admissible as an, I think Frank Caligari explained in his talks, this is admissible as an E Banach space representation. This side is a priori not admissible as an E Banach space representation, but it's admissible as a T Banach space representation. If you take its dual, you'll get its O dual will be a finitely generated module over the completed group ring of GL2ZP with T coefficients. And since this has that property with O coefficients, it also has that property with T coefficients. So we're sort of applying admissibility. This admissibility is kind of over T rho bar. But those functional analysis arguments of Schneider-Teitelbaum, they work for any complete Noetherian local ring, so it's okay. So that was kind of the completion of step one. We have a surjectivity after tensoring with E. And so you can see it really was just somehow all you do is you just interpolate classical local global compatibility. So there's not somehow so much to it, except that you sort of course, you use classical local global compatibility, and you kind of really use this fact of Berger and Breuil that gives you one handle on the p-Adic Langlands correspondence. So for step two, I couldn't. I mean, personally, no, I could. If you just take a cohomology of a Shimura curve, say, over some real quadratic field where P is in that, and you have these locally algebraic objects and they complete up into something immiscible, I don't know how you can at all understand what you get a priori. Without their theorem telling you in this one case there's no choice, as soon as you imagine there could be a spectrum of possibilities, I don't know any a method to sort of see which point in the spectrum of possibilities you actually get. So then step two. So, so for step two, we have to look at rho bar tensor pi bar, everything now over k. We look at the Homs of rho bar tensor pi bar into the H1 with k coefficients. And then there's an evaluation map into the H1 with k coefficients. And we have to show that this is injective. Because I already saw in an earlier argument that the x modulo the uniformizer, and then you take the M torsion, it embeds into this space of Homs. And so it's enough to study what happens with the space of Homs and show that this evaluation map is injective. And so the details are not very complicated. If these were irreducible, or absolutely irreducible, there's somehow nothing to say. You have something absolutely irreducible, this evaluation map is automatically injective. I guess? It is localized at rho bar, and you could have the M torsion, but somehow by Eichler Shimura, the image here automatically has to anyway land in the localization at rho bar and automatically lands in the M torsion. So if you don't write it, it's there anyway. So if these were irreducible, you're kind of done automatically. So if this pi bar is not, what sort of could happen is what you're worried about is suppose you had a Hom. Which suppose pi bar is an extension of two things, and you had a Hom which killed off the bottom, and just mapped the sort of top, the quotient, killed off the socle and embedded the co-socle, and then when you looked at this evaluation, there'd be some kernel because when you paired that homomorphism with this copy of pi bar, the socle will be being killed off. But now, you look at the pi bars, and you look at what their GL2ZP socles are. And they're exactly, the GL2ZP socle of pi bar is exactly the set of Sayre weights attached to rho bar in the sense of Sayre's conjectures, in the representation theoretic formulation that Florian Herzig explained in his talk. And now when we have these extensions, when they're two constituents in pi bar, the Sayre weight that appears in the top piece is not one of the Sayre weights for rho bar. In some sense, that's why that top piece is banished to be an extension and not a sum end, because it has, that's one reason, it has inside it a sort of putative Sayre weight that's not actually allowed when rho bar is not split. So the pieces that you don't want, so the co-socles of this as a GL2 QP representation that you don't want to be embedding in are forbidden to embed in because the Sayre conjecture. We don't need the full modularity Sayre conjecture, we just need the old-fashioned Sayre conjecture that people like Gross and Ribbett were proving. We just need to know that the only weights, Sayre weights that can appear are among the Sayre's recipe. This is sort of the easy part of Sayre's conjecture in some sense. I mean, at least now in these days, the easier part of Sayre's conjecture. So because of results on Sayre weights. This is injective. So, And in fact, we can see more, because let's imagine just for a moment that sigma naught was empty, so we were just at the level P. Then we would have classical mod P multiplicity 1 results of Mazur and Rubert and Wiles and Eddixhoven and Gross. They would tell us that each set of weight can appear just with multiplicity 1. So they would say this space has dimension 1. So that would have our x would have had full support, or the dual to x would have full support and would have one-dimensional fiber at the close point over a reduced string, so it would be free of rank 1, and our x will be co-free of rank 1. So now more generally, if we have a non-trivial sigma naught, we can take a limit, we can think about all the GL2 actions. We still kind of have mod p multiplicity 1 statements of a certain kind, so we can pin down everything about x. And maybe just because it's after 3 o'clock, let me not kind of bore you with the details of how we pin down x, and I'll stop here. So thank you for listening. That's a comment, not a question.
In principles, suppose that rho bar was reducible but not direct sum. I mean, many of these things look like they might work. I mean, I guess at the end it's somehow about showing this is objective. I mean, is there a fundamental issue? I mean, you give yourself a nice morphism of big R to big T in a reducible case.
No, I don't think so. The problem in the reducible case is essentially to prove a big R equals big T. So, I mean, also I think, for example, this one star zero cyclotomic, I think somehow, when this strategy was first worked out, Pierre's results are still in progress. And so the deformation theoretic construction of p-Adic local Langlands was sort of the only construction for some period. And now, of course, it's not. Pierre has a kind of inverse functor to the MF functor. And so in this argument, if you just wanted to prove, for example, Fontaine Mazur, so you didn't want to have this evaluation match being injective, but for example, you just wanted to show something like that X has full support, which is sort of what you need to get Fontaine Mazur, you don't really need this pi that you start with to be dead on the nose, sum up precise universal object. You just need it to have some immiscibility properties so that sort of this argument works, and have everything you care about appearing as a fiber. So you can try and just sort of cook things up. So you could, for example, start with a kind of universal gamma, some frame deformation space in the one star zero cyclotomic case, and then apply the inverse functor to the Montreal functor, and you get some kind of family of Banach space representations. And although I haven't thought through the details, I'm pretty confident that that will be enough to kind of probe H1 hat and sort of give you enough non-zero fibers to, for example, deduce Fontaine Mazur. So I think, for precise structural statements, I think, then Eisenstein or one star zero omega become issues. For kind of the core statements you need for Fontaine Mazur, I don't think they're sort of significant issues. But I think to show big R equals big T in the reducible case, well, that's a question of basically sort of somehow modifying Skinner-Wiles arguments for Hitter R equals Hitter T. And so as I've sort of said to various people here before, Kisin and I have thought about how to do this at various times, but then children kind of got in the way. I feel like there's a strategy. I mean, Skinner-Wiles give you some sort of blueprint to try and follow, and so we've thought about that, and there's some idea of sort of what are the difficulties and how you try to overcome them, but it remains to actually overcome them. Yeah, Richard?
So when you build in R equals T to this, maybe it's related to what your answer to Frank's question, do you somehow reduce it to cases that are well known, or do you repeat the arguments after taking this big limit?
No, I mean, you just have an option. I mean, you have to show big R equals big T. It has sort of nothing to do with this limit. I mean, it's a separate. I'm not sure if I understand your question.
Well,
You have an unrestricted I, you have an unrestricted T.
Yes.
And you want to, there's a map, and you want to, so Berkeley's original strategy, I guess, is he sort of uses, you know, your results in weight and whiles and so on in weight two,
yes.
And then sort of bootstraps from there.
Yes.
But in fact, I think there's an argument, really due to Mark, which I think he sketched to some extent in Toby's lectures at Harvard in the spring, that you can also just argue directly. So the ingredient you need, I should say, the ingredient you need goes back to Gervais and Mazur. It's the fern, the infinite fern, coming from the image of the Eigen curve inside deformation space. But in some sense, if you kind of look at Kisin's method, what you have this map from R to T, and what do you need to know? You somehow need to show that the T has dimension at least as great as the expected dimension of R. And that's morally sort of what you need for then the Taylor-Wiles method to give you at least that the T infinity is some union of components, spec T infinity is a union of components of spec R infinity. But again, because these local deformation rings that are unrestricted are always giving you integral domains, there's only one component in the spec R infinity. So you sort of, so at least morally.
This is after adding auxiliary primes, all of which you do at the infinite level.
In some unrestricted context. Yeah. But so morally the point at least is you have to show that T has at least dimension 3. Has at least geometric dimension 3. That's sort of the, if you like, that's the sort of, somehow there's sort of technical content in making the Taylor-Wiles-Kisin argument work. And then there's sort of some like outside input that has to come into, like, why do you expect this T to have dimension 3? So that comes from the infinite fern. I mean, as you know, so you have one dimension from twisting, and then you have this Eigen curve going through this dense set of points that we were thinking about. But because of all the branching in the Eigen curve, that fills out at least two dimensions, and so you have 1 + 2 is 3. So, yeah. So then, so this argument again is this argument, because I mean I think the most it's been written down is whatever notes people took in Toby's lecture, but I think it's.
I think
it's sound.
In
the abstracted cases, then there's the issue to Gervais and Mazur.
Yeah.
So, yeah. So for example, Berkeley's argument, I mean, the case when the deformation rings are singular, Berkeley's argument runs into trouble because he somehow uses smoothness to help him really pin down equations that are sort of cutting out these weight two loci. So this alternative argument is really only needed, for example, if you wanted to handle 1 *0 cyclotomic.
And there was a picture of Kisin in your summary.
About triangulin representations? So what Pierre is saying is that with these methods you can prove the following statement as well, which is that if you have a point rho in the spec of T rho bar or in spec of R rho bar when we're in the context where we know R equals T, and suppose it's triangulin locally at P, which is to say that at least after a twist it has a non-zero decrease, maybe not a two-dimensional decrease, but at least after a twist it has at least one crystalline period. Well, so Kisin showed one way you produce such things is finite slope over convergent forms. So the points on the Eigen curve have this property and they're twists. And so it's natural to ask whether everything with, if there's some kind of overconvergent analog of Fontaine-Mazur, so that any global rho, which is triangulin at P, comes from a point on the Eigen curve. So one can prove that with these methods. Because again, you can construct the Eigen curve. You can take a certain Jacquet module, which can construct the Eigen curve from H1 hat. And this Jacquet module applied to the pi's exactly detects whether they're, so the triangulin essentially means that you contain an analytic principle series as a dense subspace. And you can detect that with this Jacquet module's job is to detect principle series. So you can detect being crystalline, being triangulin with this Jacquet module. So somehow the same sort of argument works. So somehow this local global compatibility, I like to think, is sort of, well, I actually have some fondness for it. So I like to think of it as some statement that's kind of prior to Fontaine-Mazur or this Kisin conjecture. It's some basic reciprocity about, you know, p-Adic modular forms and Galois representations, which you can then try and use to, you know, do things you want to do. So it also has applications in the Iwasawa theory of p-Adic L functions attached to modular forms. So it's sort of, yeah, so it's some statement that you can deduce, you know, various different things from. Yeah, so also you can deduce the precise structure of locally algebraic vectors. So I quoted this result of Pierre's that the locally algebraic vectors are non-zero. And then, but then we had the mapping into some locally algebraic vectors on the cohomology, which we kind of knew by local global compatibility. And so that then tells us that the locally algebraic vectors and the p-Adic Langlands actually matched with kind of the classical picture that they should match with. And so that's how you prove, so in the supercuspidal case, which Pierre couldn't handle by purely local arguments, it's how you prove that the you make a well-chosen row bar and a well-chosen row, and then you show that the locally algebraic vectors in the p-Adic Langlands are always compatible with the classical story.
So.
Thank you.